Let's jump right into chapter 13. Look at the setting here. As Matthew tells us, verse 1, on the same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the sea. And great multitudes were gathered together to him, so that he got into a boat and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. So on the same day, we're told. And there's definitely a connection as we get into the parables with what took place in chapter 12. Now, we didn't necessarily see Jesus teach through chapter 12, although he certainly said some things, but what he said was more in response to the reaction that he got from his enemies. They were very critical of what he was doing. And specifically, we saw in chapter 12 a point of no return for a certain group of Jesus' enemies who actually said that he was tapping into the power of Satan to do these miracles and these healings and the exorcisms and the positive things he was doing for people. That's Satan at work. And Jesus said, that's the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. And there is no hope of forgiveness for such a one who does that. Now, as I said, you have to see the introduction to the parable teaching in that context. He is about to officially teach. This is not one of those reaction teaching. This is, I'm going to preach for a while. And the way that it was done back then is the teacher would actually sit and the listeners would stand. So that's what he does. He sits down by the sea, by the Sea of Galilee, and the crowds are so great that he decides to get in a little boat and kind of cast the boat off a little bit offshore so more people could see him, and now he's sitting in the boat, and they're all standing. I don't know when we reversed that, and all of you guys got to sit while I have to stand, especially as we get into four services, but nonetheless, that's our day and age. But that's what's going on. This is the formal teaching. Here we go. And he's got the multitudes there, crowds. Now, whenever the multitudes were there with Jesus, you could count on there being several haters. And haters got to hate, right? I mean, they're just there to be critical. And they are there not to learn from him, not even to be open to him, but just to look and criticize and pick on. And that's where we're at. That's the setting. And so now he begins to speak in parables. And so let's look at the first parable that we read. Verse 3, he spoke many things to them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds came and devoured them. Some fell on stony places, where they did not have much earth, and they immediately sprang up, because they had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. But others fell on good ground, and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. And you got to love that. I mean, just imagine if you're in that audience. And he gives you this little parable. A parable is an illustration, a very short little story, and it's meant to present some nugget of truth. And he gives the parable, and then he just wraps it up and says, all right, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. And that's it. He doesn't explain. He doesn't elaborate. He just leaves it there. Now, they would understand the illustration in its normal life setting, the cultural context, this sower situation. But maybe to help us out a little bit, of course, we can all relate to the idea of a guy with his seed, and he's just throwing the seed as he's sowing it as he walks through the field. Now, we usually have our property lines clearly fenced off, and if you're just walking, you know, to the fishing hole or something, you're on maybe a little path or a street, you're not walking on someone's property, typically. But of course, that wasn't how it was in ancient Israel. They had boundary markers and stones, but people would be cutting across the countryside, and they're on somebody's land. And just like happens today, typically people start walking in the same spot and a little bit of a path develops. And so that's where everyone walks. Well, that's what he's referencing there at the beginning. You know, some of the seed lands on one of these walking paths. Well, it's not going to go anywhere. There's no hope of it developing fruit, and either the rain is going to wash it away, or as Jesus says, you know, the birds say, hey, there's a free lunch, and they come down, pick it up. So that's pretty obvious. Now, the second example, though, when he talks about the stony ground, the stony places, there he's referring to not necessarily a walking path, but those parts of the land that have soil, but it's very shallow because the rock is underneath it, not too far. And as a result, the soil will stay warm and heated by the sun, and often a quick little bloom will develop. There will seem to be some life going forth there, but there's no chance for any roots to grow down deep that are necessary. And then the sun gets up, and without the root system, it just scorches and it dies off. It fades away. No fruit. We don't have to spend too much time talking about the third example. We all know about weeds and thorns and how they can choke your plants, and you want your plants to bring fruit. You got to deal with those things, but that would happen as well. The thorns get in there. And then, of course, you've got the good soil, the fourth example, which is what you would expect. Good, fertile soil. Seeds get in there, and you're going to have yourself a crop. And the crop's going to bear fruit. We're not necessarily talking fruit like, you know, apples and oranges or whatever. It could be wheat and whatever. The idea is a harvest. So they get that. But clearly, he's trying to give some sort of a spiritual lesson. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. And they don't get the opportunity to understand the lesson, do they? Because Jesus doesn't explain it to them. So now verse 10 says, the disciples came and said to him, why do you speak to them in parables? Notice the kind of the two groups. You got his disciples there, and then they're saying, why do you speak to them, the multitudes, those big crowds that are gathering? Why do you speak to them in parables? He answered and said to them, because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. For whoever has, to him more will be given, and he will have abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. We use that expression today. You're not hearing me. Well, they heard every word that came out of your mouth. You're basically saying, you don't understand my point. You don't get it. And that's what is happening here. They're certainly watching him preach. They're hearing his words, but they don't understand. But the disciples, they are in a privileged position, Jesus says. It's been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom. And mystery is, again, something that was hidden but is now revealed. So you're going to get to understand these things, but not to the multitudes. Now, verse 12 has nothing to do with the context, of course, of money or goods or anything about, you know, to whoever has, he gets more, and if you have some, it's taken away from you. But it's talking about these spiritual insights, this understanding of God's word. Now, later in the New Testament, this point is emphasized. Remember those Christians that had been Christians for quite a while, but were criticized and described as babies in Christ. And all they could handle was the milk of God's word, the real simple, basic truths of Scripture. But they've been Christians for a long time. You know, we all have to go through a baby in Christ stage. We're born again, you're a baby in Christ. But at some point, you grow and mature. And just like infants eventually get off the milk, and they begin into solid foods, so these Christians were criticized, saying, you know, you guys have been believers long enough, you ought to be on some strong meat by now. You ought to be able to really understand, you know, God's word and the doctrines of Christ. And they didn't. And it was according to their fault, because they could have if they had been serious about these things. So Jesus is saying that the multitudes, they don't understand. Now, here is the point of controversy. There are some who argue, although I think it is a very flimsy argument, that Jesus then uses the parables to somehow explain to these people. You know, oh, they're so ignorant on spiritual things. Let me give you a little children's story to explain. That's not what's happening. That's not it. No, they don't understand, period. End of sentence. And if there's any doubt, any challenge to that, look as we continue on, verse 14. Jesus is actually using parables to hide the truth from the multitudes. And that sounds pretty wild the first time you hear it, or say it, whatever. But look at verse 14. And in them, the multitudes, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, hearing you will hear and shall not understand, and seeing you will see and not perceive. For the hearts of this people have grown dull. Their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn, so that I should heal them. So it's about a deliberate rejection of God's truth and the consequences of that rejection when it comes to understanding spiritual truth. That's what's the issue here, and that's why, as I said in my opening, the timing, the connection to the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit that Jesus' enemies were guilty of, you know, you can't ignore that. They're tied together here. So he's deliberately leaving the multitudes in the dark, but explaining things to his disciples. Now, here is a very significant point, though, and the Isaiah prophecy brings it out a little bit. There is nothing at all, nothing whatsoever, to prevent someone. If you're one of those guys in the multitude, you come out of your little house and you hear that Jesus is preaching, and you go out and you listen to it, you're part of the multitude, you hear that parable, there's nothing to prevent you from seeking out the Lord and wanting to understand and to know what he's saying. Anyone who comes to the Lord with a seeking heart, I'm sorry, no, I don't have time for you. That's not at all the case, is it? Jesus is dealing with those people, as I said, who are sitting there going, what idiocy is this guy going to say now? You know, let's find something to jump on him here. You know, those are the guys that he's dealing with. He's not going to waste his time with those people. Kind of reminds me of the don't cast your pearls before swine. And think about it when it comes to our lives. Does God tell you, Christian, I want you to argue that atheist into the kingdom no matter how long it takes? You know, it doesn't work that way, does it? And at some point, you speak the truth in love. You tell them, you know, Jesus loves you and he died for your sins. You need to receive him. But I'm not going to sit here and argue all day about the flood and the creation and all that, you know, because you don't believe any of that stuff. You don't care. I've got answers. And if you ask me legitimate questions because you're really seeking an understanding of God's word and his revelation, we can talk all day. But that's not usually what people want to do, right? If they're already got their mind set up in a place of rejection, just argument. And so, Jesus is actually fulfilling prophecy by declaring the things of God to people who do not understand them. Though, once more, they closed their eyes. They hardened their hearts. They stopped up their ears. And if they would open their eyes and open their ears, there is always that chance for repentance and acceptance by God. And so, therefore, the contrast continues on. Verse 16, no longer quoting from Isaiah, Jesus speaking to the disciples said, but blessed are your eyes, for they do see, and your ears, for they hear. For assuredly, I say to you, many prophets and righteous men desired to see what you see, did not see it, to hear what you hear, and did not hear it. Kind of mixes the two references. On the one hand, you know, you see, you hear with the understanding, with the comprehension. How blessed are your eyes and your ears. And then the reference to the Old Testament saints and prophets. Oh, man, how they wanted to be in your shoes, to live in these times, to be able to hear what you're getting a chance to hear. But, of course, they died before Jesus came. So, he's explained why he's speaking to them in parables very clearly. To the multitudes now. But the disciples are going to get the insight. God is going to speak to the disciples. God, namely Jesus, who is God incarnate. And you see, that's the thing about the Word of God. Whether it was spoken by Jesus, or whether we read it in the Bible, God is the one who gives us the understanding of His Word. Amen? That's why we read that little passage from Corinthians in our opening as part of our service today. That reminder that, you know, the natural man, person in their unsaved state, without the Holy Spirit, they can read the words on the page. That's not the challenge, but to understand what God's words say. That's the difference. Well, the disciples don't have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit yet, right? We're still early in that time plan of God. So Jesus himself is going to explain to them. And so that's exactly what he does. Now, what's beautiful about this, church, is that we don't have to argue about what the details mean. I mean, when Jesus tells you this is what it means, the word means this, and the birds are this, and the ground is this, that ends the discussion, right? So our only challenge then is the application of it. So let's look, though, first at what Jesus explains that the different symbolisms mean in his little parable. Verse 18, therefore hear the parable of the sower. And this is called the parable of the sower based on Jesus' reference right here, although sometimes you'll hear people talk about the parable of the four soils. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is he who receives seed by the wayside. So the immediate snatching away, symbolized by the birds going and taking the seed when it lands on the pathway. Verse 20, but he who received the seed on stony places, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy, yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. For when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. So this is the second example where there is that thin layer of soil and it produces an immediate growth, but it does not last, and eventually it is burned out and you don't see it any longer. Now the third, verse 22, he who receives seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. Again, the one that mixed with the thorns choke the word. No fruit. And then lastly, he who received the seed on the good ground is he who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. So there's no debate about what the symbolism means, but the challenge for us is how do we apply it? Now let me tell you how this parable is applied many times, which I will disagree with. Too often I have seen this parable applied only in the context of sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, preaching the gospel. Now, I'm not saying that preaching the gospel would not be included, because certainly when you are talking about the Word of God, you're talking about the gospel. But that is far, far too narrow of an understanding if you limit it to just the gospel. Now, first of all, let's define a couple more terms. When I talk about the gospel of our salvation, the gospel that saves, what are we talking about? Again, there's no confusion on this. Paul is very clear in 1 Corinthians. Christ died for our sins and was buried. He rose from the dead and was seen by eyewitnesses. He literally died, he literally bodily rose from the dead, but he died and rose for our sins. That's the gospel, and we are to call on Jesus and believe in him, and whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved and forgiven and given eternal life, and we're born again, we have the spiritual birth, we must receive Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. So the first problem I have with that being the only application for this parable is pretty simple. Jesus hasn't said a word about any of that yet, has he? Has Jesus been telling the people about his coming crucifixion and resurrection? No. We've made that point many times. There was a little bit of a glimpse when he did that enigmatic, you know, 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth, just like Jonah was in the belly of the great fish. But he's not talking about dying for the sins of the world and rising again. We're not anywhere near that yet. But he has been proclaiming the word. We've seen the word going forth throughout the chapters of Matthew so far at this point of the ministry. So if you just focus it on the gospel, you've got a problem with that because Jesus hasn't even mentioned the gospel yet. The other problem you have is, of course, then all the Christians say, well, amen, I received the gospel. I must be one of those fourth soil guys, the good ones, you know, and I don't really have to worry about this parable the rest of my life. Wouldn't that be a logical conclusion if it's all about receiving Jesus Christ? And then you know what else happens? Then we begin to argue about the second and the third soil. Is that guy really saved? Maybe he's one of those second soil people or one of the third soil people. And people have this argument and they use that as their proof text that somehow you can, you know, be saved and then reject it later and all the rest of it. No. See, that's the issue. It's way too narrow, and it's a big mistake to look at it that way. No, he's talking about the word of God, the word of the kingdom going forth, and the responses to the word. And if we're willing to broaden it beyond the gospel, then it hits us right between the eyes. Because we're confronted with the word of God every time we open the pages, aren't we? There's a lot in this book. Every time you're here on a Sunday and I'm given a message which is coming from the word, even if you're listening to, you know, Christian radio program where they're teaching from the word, hopefully. And these reactions are reactions that any one of us might be guilty of. I won't ask for a show of hands. Let's take them in order. You come across something in the word that just really pushes your button a little bit. God would want me to do what? Forget that. No way. I understand about forgiveness and all that stuff, Pastor. And yeah, forgiveness is a pretty good principle. But that guy did some things to me that are unforgivable. And it's just like the first soil, right? Just, I'm not listening to it. I'm not going to hear it. That's it. Done. And I guarantee you, if that's your attitude, Satan's whispering ears, saying, yeah, you don't have to listen to that. No, 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 that doesn't apply to you. Come on, after what he did to you. Right? Just like the birds taking it out. No fruit whatsoever has even a hope of developing with someone who comes to the word of God and says, that doesn't apply to me, forget that. Alright? And again, it can happen to any one of us. Maybe it's not so much it doesn't apply to me. It doesn't apply to me today. Oh, yeah, I know I got to get around to that someday, right? I know I got to forsake my sin someday. I know I got to make it to someday, right? But not now. No fruit. Then there's the time when the word of God just sets you on fire, right? You receive it with great joy. You're in there, maybe it's a Sunday sermon. I can't wait till Monday morning, man. I'm going to go to the job site. I'm going to share with my coworkers what I learned from the word of God. I am so on fire and all that. Praise the Lord. And you go out there, and lo and behold, guess what? They don't want to hear it. They begin to huddle up and circle up and start mocking you and singling you out and say, why don't you just go away? We don't care about what you're Bible thumping around here. A little persecution, a little tribulation arises because of the word's sake. You're offended. And what's the response? Oh, hey guys, you got me all wrong. All right, I got a little carried away there, but you know, we're all good. Let's go out tonight. Right? And immediately, that quick burst is gone. Again, can happen to any Christian, and it no doubt has, if we were being honest, on more than one occasion in our lives. myself included. How about the third? Again, the idea of like, yeah, that sounds good, that sounds great, or whatever. And then you start thinking a little bit further, ooh, but if I commit to that, I might cut into my NFL viewing time. You know? And or it might, you know, yeah, those missionaries, they could use our support, but man, I could use a new speedboat. And, you know, whatever it is, the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches creeping in. You get fired up and say, yes, I need to be sold out. It doesn't matter what we do on this earth. It, you know, lay up treasures in heaven. That's what Jesus taught. And you get fired up on that. But then when it actually comes into practice, all of a sudden it's just the cares of this world. Because there's a sacrifice that's necessary. And now, I don't know if I really want to commit the sacrifice. And once more, no fruit. Do you see, this isn't about getting booted to hell. This isn't about, well, that's it, you're going to hell. I mean, God certainly can't forgive you for that attitude. No, but it's about the war that we all face, the spirit and the flesh and the flesh and the spirit, and they are battling every single day while we're in these fallen bodies on this fallen earth until God calls us to glory. And then, of course, the fourth example is almost self-explanatory. Yes. I'm going to live my life. I'm going to put into practice what God's word tells me. And I don't care if I get laughed at or hated or physically assaulted, which happens to Christians in some parts of the world. And I don't care what it costs me in terms of time or treasure or my talents, because I want to do it. There's the fourth example. And there's where you're going to have the fruit. Again, it's not simply a one-time application that you just stamp on your life. It's a day-by-day decision. It comes every time you open up God's Word. And that's why we have to come to God's Word with those open hearts. And Lord, you speak to me. I'm not going to bring my judgment on your Word. You tell me the right way to live. You tell me what to believe and what to deny. You tell me how I can live for you in this fallen world, because that's the Bible's filled with that information for us all. The thing about this parable, and again, why I emphasize the fact that if you just only look at salvation and think that's the only application that's involved here, you don't really see it, because the issue here in all four cases is about bearing fruit, is it not? The fourth soil bore fruit. The others didn't, and the reasons they didn't are explained. Isn't that fascinating? That if you think about God's word, and you think about the possible reactions, responses to God's word, there's really only four. I mean, Jesus covered them all. There's the people who say, no way, forget it, I don't want anything to do with it. And then there's people like, amen, I'm going to do it. Those are the either ends of the spectrum. That's one in four, you could say. And then there's the people who say, well, I really think it sounds good, but I'm not really committed enough to do it. That would be the third cares of this world. And then there's the people who say, yeah, I want to do it, but I'm afraid to, and I don't want it to cost my friends. And you know, that's the second. I mean, those are the only responses, isn't it? You can put everything in one of those four camps. But you see, to bear fruit, and now I'm going to kind of mix passages here, because Jesus talks about fruit bearing in the Gospel of John when he says, you are the branches and I'm the vine. Abide in me. Abide in the vine. And if you abide in the vine, you will bear much fruit. The thing about bearing fruit is it's the natural process that comes from just abiding in Christ, isn't it? Just like fruit on the plant. You know, you never see the plant like, trying to get the fruit, you know, to come out of the branches or something, right? It just develops. Now, you know what else happens? It takes a little time sometimes for fruit to develop too, right? You know, hey, I'm hungry for some apples. We planted that tree 2 days ago. Are we eating? You know, hold on, man. It takes a little while for the fruit to develop. And it comes in at different levels. Again, God uses us in different ways. It doesn't mean that someone is more loyal and faithful to God than another because, you know, they have this big ministry and they seem to have a small ministry. That's not the issue. But the fruit will come as we abide in Christ. And that's, again, it's a daily choice that we make, brothers and sisters. We do it every time we come to God's Word. We know what God's Word says. We can either obey or disobey. Be doers of the Word, as James said. Or just be hearers only. Let us be doers. Let's recognize these temptations are in all of our lives whenever we're confronted with God's Word. And yet, we know that our Lord loves us, and those times when we do fail, oh, I was such a coward today, or like, oh, I was so slothful. Christ's grace is forgiveness. His grace, His mercy, His love is sufficient for us. He does not die for our sins, and then once we become born again, He says, now you better go live perfectly or you're going to hell. It doesn't work that way. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us constantly, 24/7. And so we need the Lord daily, every day, every hour. But we are responsible for the choices we make in our lives. We choose to obey or disobey. We choose to commit, to sell out, or to be lukewarm and to be worldly and to be fearful. And so, may we make those choices in the power of the Holy Spirit this week.